This is Andrew Zimmern, and this is a selected chapter from my book, The Bizarre Truth, or How I Went Out the Door Mouth First and Came Back Shaking My Head. Experiencing food and sharing culture is what a traveler's life is all about, and exchanging our stories makes the world a more useful place. Viva Cuba! The recent thaw in Cuban-American relations coincided with my recent trip there last spring. Travel can be transformative. One person from one country, representing their own blend of culture and experience, meets another citizen of the world on their home turf. This is what makes what I do for a living such a powerful force for growth and change in the world. People often see me as the bug-eating guy, but I have only eaten bugs a handful of times in a few memorable minutes in hundreds of hours sprinkled across my television career. I see myself as creating a powerful voice for globalism and international understanding, for the idea that by sharing food, we experience another culture in unique personal ways, by breaking bread with real people in truly local haunts, eating honest and authentic cuisine. You'll never get the full picture clinging close to a hotel lobby. By focusing on our commonalities, like our mutual love of food, we can really share life with people we just met in lands far away. We forget our differences and the matters of our daily life that can only lead to conflict and misunderstanding. Cross the first barrier, share a meal, and the next conversation can safely be had. Trust me on this. I spent a week in Chile last year. It wasn't until I shared a meal in a Chilean home that I finally got the real story about the struggles of dissidents, changes in national identity, and personal experience with both. Try learning that by shoving a microphone in someone's face. It has happened for me in China, Vietnam, France, and Italy, even Tennessee. It was here that a young woman confided her personal story in me. We sat quietly in a corner, and I listened, eating possum neck and dunking my cornbread in pot liquor from the greens. Just a Jew from New York and a mountain girl from rural Appalachia, trusting each other because we were sharing a meal. Look what happened when the Berlin Wall fell, or in 1971 when the U.S. State Department lifted the ban on travel to China, leading up to the presidential visit there in 73 that birthed the week that changed the world. A lot happened over dinner and dumplings, I can assure you. Mutual distrust with Russia and China, Vietnam, and other formerly closed worlds replaced by an advancing understanding and ongoing free exchange of ideas. Opportunity feeds relationships. I am of the mind that if it can happen with those countries, it can happen now with Cuba, a country 90 miles from our back door. And I believe that cultural and political osmosis begins with a meal. I went to Cuba with an open mind and an open heart. I spent time in Havana, lounged at the Nacional, stayed in Frank Sinatra's old room, prowled the music clubs, danced to the salsa beat, visited with world-famous artists, and strolled the ancient cobblestone streets of Vieja Havana. I saw for myself the beauty, inside and out, of this amazing country, and I believe more than ever that restrictions and barriers do nothing but foment misunderstanding and make life tougher on citizens of both our countries. We are all richer for a free-flowing exchange of ideas, and the people of Cuba feel the same way. I asked. We have a rare opportunity here to see a country on our doorstep redevelop in many ways, and the stagnating isolation of the last 50 years has been our loss. Canadians and Europeans, South Americans and Africans all travel safely to Cuba every day. They are the richer for it. We are the losers here. And I can proudly say we have a lot to offer Cuba. I ache to see the walls removed, not created. I believe travel is a game changer for remaking our world in a more positive way, and I can safely tell you that Cuba is a once-in-a-lifetime travel experience. The country isn't diluted or polluted by the corrosive aspects of culture that prevent our seeing what a people are really like or how they live. In some cases, Cuba is a paradise prison. 99% of Cubans can't get on a boat, even to go fishing. Beef is considered contraband, and markets are sparsely stocked despite many resources. However, the country is changing at breakneck speed, and the sooner you see it for yourself, the better. Once the palm curtain rises, the country is changed forever, for good and for bad. The doors to Cuba will open soon, and trust me, once they do, it will transform at a rapid rate. Look what happened in Eastern Europe. Estonia, for example, carried on in a style more like the Bronze Age than the modern age for hundreds of years. The moment the borders opened up, they experienced a Western technology boom, bypassed hundreds of years of development, and eased into the 21st century overnight. In Estonia, you can pay for a bus, a movie, or a parking meter with your cell phone. Estonia entered the modern era at warp speed. It certainly would not surprise me to see a similar change in Cuba. I'm sure they'll devalue one of their two currencies, the Cuban peso, which is the official currency used by the citizenry, and the Cuban convertible peso, or CUC, which is typically used by tourists and was created to take foreign currency out of circulation, and the rush will be on. Take one nighttime stroll in Havana, one of the most glamorous cities in the world, and you'll quickly discover the intoxicating sights, smells, and sounds of this sexy, caliente hot environment. The old Russian buildings serving as state-run hotels in some of the most beautiful parts of the country will be demolished. Most are empty anyhow, but they will finally be nudged out of the market by grand five-star resorts. The Four Seasons in Trinidad, Cuba is not far from becoming a reality. Giant tourism companies offering too-good-to-be-true packages, cruise ships overtaking the harbors, Katie bar the door. This place is going to be crowded in a hurry. My advice? Get down there while you can, because when the Palm Curtain does rise, or is it proper to say it will fall, it'll only be a few years before you are looking at Nassau, Jamaica, theme parks, or maybe even worse, the Dominican, a country where barbed wire surrounds the great resorts to keep the locals and the guests from intermingling, unless you count the towel attendant near your cabana. Talk about a place that's ripe for a revolution. I flew from Minnesota to Toronto, then on to Havana's Jose Marti Airport, armed only with some elemental credentials for the Cuban government. The issue for Americans is in returning and in finding external travel help in booking reservations. Domestic travel businesses won't even talk to you about Cuba. American travel to Cuba isn't illegal per se, but the U.S. government prohibits Americans from spending money there. Our production company made the necessary arrangements working through a British company doing business in Cuba. I was nervous, even jittery, leaving Toronto. I've never been harassed or felt like I was in danger from any official representative. I figured the worst that could happen is having to spend the night in the airport and head right back home the next morning. But things went smoothly going in. I landed, breezed through immigration, and met our fixers, who took me to get my official credentials at the Cuban Press Association's office in Havana. I continued on to our hotel, the Park Central, located on the edge of the historic old city. Our stay coincided with the International Conference of Non-Aligned Nations, with every crackpot, two-bit dictator and his delegates flooding the hotel. This made for great people watching. If observing awkward security shakedowns and marveling at the audacity of snotty teenage diplomats is your idea of a fun time. The events of the conference made for more traffic, crowded eateries and cultural events, and increased security at every hotel in town. It also meant getting bumped from my room at the Nacional, where I had been booked for months. No matter, the PC was a great hotel, and ironically, the rooms were a lot nicer. New hotel, foreign owner, partners means nicer everything. Even with international heads of state around, the Cubans can't quite get it together enough to serve anything other than tinned imported ham on the breakfast buffet line at the Nacional, where I did manage to stay my last 2 days in country. The Nacional is one of the great hotels in the world from a historical and cultural standpoint. This was the place to see and be seen in the decades leading up to La Revolución. In its current condition, I felt I was visiting an ailing legend on its deathbed. Think Gloria Swanson in Sunset Boulevard. The food is terrible, the service bottomed out, the grounds unkempt. The cleanliness factor appeared to have reached an all-time low. Despite the hotel's condition, I found my stay thrilling in the extreme. Sipping a virgin mojito in the same spot as Churchill, taking in the view of the ocean beyond the Malecón was simply surreal. I stood on the same space occupied by every legendary gangster, international jet-setter, president, and king who lived in the first half of the 20th century. I even slept in the Frank Sinatra and Ava Gardner honeymoon suite. Not the luxurious accommodations I'd expected. Dingy, oddly small, located on the second floor with an average view, and offering no amenities at all. I'm no dilettante, but this room didn't strike me as the way Frank would roll. I did sleep in the bed he shtupped the lovely Miss Gardner in, and that was enough for me. The Nacional is rich with stories and history. Everything from the visible shell marks on the outer walls of the hotel from the 1933 Sergeant's Coup to the incredible smoking lounges where kings and princes sat enjoying a late-night cigar and a glass of aged rum makes the hotel as romantic and classic a spot as you'll ever find. The famous Parisian nightclub, though not as big and swanky as the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.